Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is Hany Ismail from Planning Engineer website. In this video, we are going to discuss the cash flow and SCurve. Now we have activities, dates, relationships, cost, and hours. We know the cost of each activity alone. We can sum to get the cost of each zone, building area, or even the project. If the total cost of a project is 5 million, does the contractor have to own the 5 million in his hands before starting the project? Here comes the importance of cash flow. Cash flow is simply distributing money over time. Instead of only knowing the total cost of the project is 5 million, we need to know how these 5 million are distributed over the time span of the project. We need to see the cash flow to get the following. What is the cash out peak for the contractor? Can he satisfy the peaks? Does the S-curve seem logical or not? So the project cash flow, or the cost over time, it is something like this. We have here month or week. Then we have number representing the in or out, don't be confused between in and out, cash flow, during the project time span. For example, in this month, we see that in April, we need 80. This 80 could be cost, could be hours, could be anything. But the idea of the cash flow, and since it is cash, we will talk about costs. But we can do the same for resources, and I will explain to you in another video. But the concept is the same. So we distribute the amount of the project over time. From this distribution, week by week or month by month, then we can build the S-curve. The S-curve is a graphic that displays the cumulative cost over a specific period of time. It is called S-curve because it is normally the looks like S shape, as you can see here. So the project cost over time, we can identify in each month what is the in or out. Now let me talk a little bit about this one. I didn't make a special presentation for it or a special slide, but I would like to tell you how usually the cash flow is done. Let's say here we are going to spend 10 in the month of Jan. Then in the month of February, we will spend 30. But since we spent on the month of Jan 10, we did a work that worth 15. Then it will come to this month. It will be paid after 1 month. And from this one, we will have in 15 and out is 30. This we call net cash flow. This is something else related to the cost control, where they can find in which months we should finance the project. As we mentioned earlier, that if there is a project with 100 million, do the investor or the project contractor should have the 100 million in the hand to start the project? Definitely not. He is comparing the in and out and see where is the shortage and how much, accordingly plan his project. The project budget distribution over time usually takes bill shape for the most of the project. What I mean by bill shape? It is like this. So we started here at very low, then we increase the cost, then again we go low. Like this shape, it is a bill curve, also known as the S-curve. At the beginning of the project, the rate of work is usually slow. Not all manpower or resources are in the project yet. Usually the project starts with mobilization activities, which are cheap and don't need a lot of resources. That's why we starting with this shape or this slope, which is showing that the cost at this stage is not too much. Accordingly, the relevant work are not too much. The steeper the slope gets, the higher cost need for this period. As we can see here, if we compare these months, we'll find that the curve will be like this, which is shaping the bell curve, because in the middle of the project, we expect a high cost slope. At the end of the project and the beginning of the project, we expect low slope, which means we are going to spend less money. We talked about the budget distribution curve. What about the S-curve? Let's calculate the cumulative cost over time and use it to draw the S-curve. So this is a budget distribution, and when we make it as a cumulative, it will draw this line, and this line is called the S-curve, which is showing the cumulative amount of money spent during the project. When the slope of the S-curve is steep like this one, it means that you have to spend a lot of money. When you say you have to spend a lot of money, it should be reflected to the amount of work you are executing. So we have here, we are expecting to have here a lot of work to be done in this period. On the other hand, the opposite is true. When the slope is low or moderate, you know that this is a period where you are not doing too much money or you are not doing too much work. We said that we convert the work to money. So here at the beginning and at the end, no much work is being done. Conclusion: S-curve is used to give an indication of your project overall cash flow. The S-curve is used to know when you have a lot of work, which equal to the cost. Overall shape of the cash flow can tell if the project is front loaded or back loaded. This is new term. Let's talk about the front loaded S-curve and back loaded S-curve. Front loaded S-curve concentrate a significant portion of activities and resources at the beginning of the project, allowing for quick progress and early milestones. On the other hand, backloaded S-curve, the schedule, large portion of the schedule will be done at the end of the project. And I'm going to tell you from my experience, the best experience or the tips and the tricks you should take care of. So this is the shape of the front-loaded schedule. You can see here that too much activities is being done at the very beginning of the project. And to be honest, if you see this shape, unless you have a very good reason to have this one, you should raise your red flag, because some contractors might put the early activity, they put very high weight, okay, in order to get cash. For example, I have a project with $50 million. I can say, okay, the concrete work will cost $40 million and all other works will cost $10 million. Since the concrete work is being done at the beginning, okay, so as a contractor, I'll get too much money at the very beginning of the project. This is not a standard practices, and in some stages, let's say I am not a good contractor, okay, I decided that at this stage, I'll not continue the project, so I am paid more than what I deserve. So the front-loaded S-curve is not a good practice. Don't use it. And also, the back-loaded schedule is not good practice. Let's say you are a contractor or client and you are telling your contractor, okay, this is your payment schedule. It means when I look to this one, it is not bell curve. See, that this portion should equal to this portion. I should also raise the red flag. Why my payment is too much delayed to the very end of the project? Whether there is something here, unless there is very good reason why I'm not get paid here, it means I will suffer. My cash flow for my company will be a nightmare. So this also need to be studied very well, because you are doing a lot of work and you are not getting paid, or the amount of work, it might require too many resources, but the cost of these activities is not expensive. So also, the backloaded S-curve is not a good practice. For being a planning manager in several projects, when I review the subcontractors and main contractors' schedules, I also question if we have backloaded schedule or front-loaded schedule. I need to have a very reasonable schedule where it is representing the actual work will be done on site. I don't want them to get paid too much or more than they did. Also, I don't want them to be in trouble, because if the backloaded schedule will cause them a cash flow issues. I hope you enjoyed this lesson. See you in the next one.